Hello and welcome to Node.link 2020. Thank you for joining us today, everyone. I'm Aris from City.js Conference. City.js is a community conference that is held in London and it's also broadcast around the world. It is a joint event from the London meetups. This is a fantastic opportunity for the JavaScript community and for those that want to find out more about what are the latest changes, to be updated on innovating changes around the industry and the JS in general. I'd like to introduce you to our speaker, Jan Zak, a freelance data visualization engineer, also a consultant, who is also presenting the building a graph visualization with PIXI.js. Jan is a freelance data visualization engineer and specializes in high performance geospatial and Node.link graph visualizations in web applications. He's an author of popular open libraries and a frequent contributor. Thank you and welcome, Jan.
Thank you for the introduction. Hello, welcome to Montreal, building a graph WebGL graph visualization with PIXI.js. My name is Jan Zak, as you heard, and I'm a freelance data visualization engineer. In this talk, I'm going to show you how you can build a high performance graph visualization with generic drawing tools. So imagine that you want to draw a Node.link graph. What are you going to draw? Depending on the use case, there are a few fundamental objects. There is node shape. It can be a circle, square, or any other polygon. There is Node.link, node icon or image, which helps you to visually identify a node or a node type. There is node label to identify the node. It can be an ID, a name, or anything, any other string that describes the entity represented by the node. And lastly, there are edge lines to represent graph relationships. Now let's shift to the technology which can be used for drawing. If your graph is fairly large in size, let's say above 1000 nodes or so, you are definitely going to need WebGL. I'm going to give you a very quick introduction to WebGL. So what it is? There is a common misconception that WebGL is a 3D drawing API. Well, that's not true, because in reality, WebGL is just a low-level 2D drawing API. The most complex object that it allows you to draw is a triangle. However, it does so with native GPU acceleration, and that's why it's so fast. Remember that WebGL is really all about triangles. In order to use WebGL, you would need to start seeing triangles in everything. Let's quickly compare Canvas and WebGL APIs. There are methods for drawing a line in Canvas API. How about WebGL? Well, you are out of luck. You need to draw two triangles. Or if you care about anti-aliasing, it's six triangles or even more triangles if the lines consist of multiple line segments and you want to have pretty line joints or caps with rounded corners or so. Next, there is a method for drawing a circle on canvas. How about in WebGL? Well, it's triangles again. You need to split the circle into triangle arcs. Or there is another option. You can use a pre-rendered circle texture and overlay it on two triangles. Such two triangles are usually called a quad. Next, and there is a method for drawing an image circle in Canvas, an image in Canvas. How about WebGL? You could already guess that this is simple. Again, you can simply overlay the image on a quad. Again, a quad is two triangles representing a rectangle called a quad. So now let's do something complicated. There is a method for drawing text in Canvas. How about WebGL? Here you can convert the font into triangles. It gives you the best details possible, but there is a lot of triangles for long text. And this is definitely not good for performance, and we need to reduce the amount. So what are the other possibilities? You can pre-render each string into a texture and overlay the texture on a quad. However, this doesn't scale well for a lot of text, and because you would need a lot of textures for each line, a new texture, and so on. The other option is better to split the text into characters and render each character with its own quad and the texture for the character. Characters can be arranged into a shared texture called the texture atlas. However, there is one disadvantage with textures that I haven't mentioned yet. It doesn't zoom in well. Ideally, you should have the texture pre-rendered in the largest expected size. Fortunately, there is a solution for this. It's called sign distance fields. It's a texture which contains encoded vector shapes. Either you can use the simpler grayscale SDFs, which are usually good enough, but you can still see artifacts with extreme zoom in, or you can use so-called multi-channel SDFs, which encodes the vector shape in all color channels and allow you to reproduce the shape precisely. Isn't that too much to learn when you want to just draw high-level objects? Fortunately, you can use drawing libraries, which abstract you away from the WebGL complexities. While it's useful to understand how they work in behind, you don't need prior WebGL knowledge to start with them. I chose PIXI.js because it has a lot of features and plugins and it has an active community. Out of the box, it supports WebGL and WebGL version 2 renders. Also, you can get an automatic fallback to Canvas with PIXI legacy package, and no other change are required to your code. The plugins that I used for development of the following visualization are PIXI viewport for moving and zooming the viewport, and PIXI essential / cal for hiding objects outside of the viewport, just improving performance. For rendering with PIXI, it's important to lay out your scene tree. On the highest level, I have the viewport object. Viewport contains layers for nodes, node labels, and edges. Node layer contains circles, borders, icons. Node labels layer contain label background and text. And final edges layer contain lines. The reason for ordering the layers is that they are drawn in the same order. Therefore, edges are drawn first, then nodes, and so on. Also, I added separate empty layers for rising up objects so that they appear on top of the other objects when they are hovered. And here's the result. Is it done? Oh, not yet. There are many features that can be added for improving the readability in separate levels of detail by zoom level. Here you can see when zooming out, first node levels disappear, then node icons disappear, and then edges disappear. Also, it gives a nice performance boost when zoomed out. There are many features left to do, such as stretching the distance between nodes when zooming, hiding overlapping labels, or graph manipulation. Also, PIXI SDF text plugin unfortunately doesn't support the latest version of PIXI version 5 yet. So the plugin needs to be updated first before I could use it. For now, I'm using Bitmap Texture Atlas. I haven't talked yet about the graph model. I used Graphology library because I believe that the model's storage and all algorithms, including layouts, can be shared across multiple libraries. Graphology is a standalone graph model specification and a reference implementation, meaning that for very specific cases, one can write their own implementation and it's going to work with all other Graphology libraries. The standard library includes graph theory algorithms, graph layouts, and various utilities such as graph generators. I believe that Graphology could become an ecosystem to share new graph algorithms and layout in JavaScript, so that users, developers are not locked in a particular library and anyone can easily use it. Graphology is actually already used by Sigma.js version 2, which is currently in development, but already available in a branch. Thanks to Graphology, I also easily implemented data-driven styling. I can define each style property either with a static value or a function which takes any node or edge as an input and can return the style value. Now we have time for a quick demo. Here it is, and you can see that it's the same as on the slides, and I can zoom in to see the details. I can zoom out, and now we see the levels of details feature kicking in because labels got hidden. When I'm zooming out again, then icons got hidden, and when I'm zooming out even more, then edges got hidden so that we see only node shapes. And this helps with performance with very large graphs a lot. Also, you can see that when I'm hovering any node, then the node rises up over the other nodes so that it gives user focus on the hovered node. This is all from the features. And going back to the slides, here is a list of very interesting resources. If you are wondering how WebGL works for 2D rendering, you can take a look at them. And now it's time for a quick Q&A session. Is the code of the demo available? Yes, I published the source code in my PIXI graph repository with demo deployed online. And the goal is to publish the repository as an NPM library one day when I think it's reasonably finished and can be used by anyone online. Another question that I expect is, what are the upcoming features? Well, there are a lot of possibilities. If you are interested in using PIXI Graph, you can help me by filling in a survey at the link on the screen. Help me with prioritizing features, send questions, or any other feedback if you have. Thank you for listening for my talk, and I hope for reading the survey. Thank you.